determine, which means the ICU doctors need to be knowledgeable about this. Now, when the families are approached, they should... Let's look at, this is the latest news, India's organ transplant paradox. We are world number two as far as organ transplants are concerned. US has 35,000 transplants in a year. We have around 8,000 transplants in a year. We are world number two. But most of them are living donors. We are happy to go to a relative and say, why don't you end up donating one of your kidney or part of your liver? How sad is that? And while we burn the organs or bury organs.
When I first finished my MD in pathology, my first job as a young doctor was to be a blood bank officer. So people used to come and donate blood. But we had groups of people from certain communities coming and threatening us to give that blood to a particular community. Now, is that ethical? Can I do it? No. So these are the problems that we face. And what has happened now, like Madam said, you know, the need for the organ is much more than what is available. And we are lagging behind in terms of organ donation. So there are many issues that will face a person who is receiving an organ as well as the person who is donating. What happens is, once they receive the organ, they don't take it or seal it.
Okay.
So this is a very nice movie. We use this to teach our medical students. Okay. Now, what is the what was the story behind in this movie is, this baby is created just to be a blood donor and a marrow donor for her sister who has leukemia. And this child, without her consent, you know, her parents forced her to donate her marrow and her blood. At some stage, the sister starts deteriorating and her kidneys fail. So she, the parents look at this child to
very young, energetic crowd, and a very nice panel over here.
Under transplant beds, and they're all occupied. And this is what makes them feel that the Falun Gong are actually serving as a donor. So this is indispensable aspects in transplant medicine. In transplant medicine, we normally talk about trust and transparency. Trust is built on transparency, and transparency is organ procurement and transplant numbers. Transparency, of course, is a measurable variable.
Favorite section of this conclave, a panel discussion moderated by none other than Ms. Faye D'Souza. She's a television news anchor and the former executive director of Mirror Now. Constantly in the front lines of the Fourth Estate, she fights for the rights of the marginalized. Ms. Faye. You're good to go, cool. Yeah, no problem. We also have a very special guest that you might have had a sneak peek walking in. She has not only portrayed impactful and memorable characters in her career, spanning over two decades, but has also been at the forefront of various noble causes related to women welfare and empowerment. Truly an inspiration to women, she has also been part of various prestigious conclaves, panels and NGOs, thereby helping them create more awareness related to their safety and education. At a very young age, she adopted two girls, encouraging other hopeful parents to consider adoption. She has also received an award for the women in, from the Women and Child Ministry of India for work for women empowerment. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Ms. Ravina Tandon on the dais. seat ready for you. And I think I will hand over to Ms. D'Souza because she knows the names. So.
Good afternoon. Can you guys hear me at the back?
Yes.
I'm very impressed with how many of you showed up and gave up your morning to talk about organ donation. I think that's really cool. On my way over here, I was concerned about talking to young people about organ donation. It's a very morbid subject, right? It's not sexy. And I was wondering how we could possibly inspire young people to consider pledging organs or even consider thinking about this subject, because when you're young, the last thing you want to think about is death. But then I considered that we do live in a country where a 19-year-old picked up a gun and shot a 21-year-old just yesterday. So young people are already thinking about death. And what better way to battle that thought and that hatred than to talk about saving lives today? Because technically, when you donate an organ, or when you receive an organ, you don't care if that organ came from a Hindu or a Muslim or a Christian, or if that organ came from someone who ate meat, or someone who believed that women need equal rights, or someone who believed that you should be able to marry whoever you want to, irrespective of gender. The organs don't care. And I believe we're having this conversation today because saving lives and love is the only answer to hatred and division. And only the young people can do that today. So I'm really grateful for all of you for coming in today to have this conversation about how we can save more lives in our country. Number. I mean, imagine tomorrow if we discover that one of our loved ones needs an organ and now is at the end of the back of that 5 lakh line. That's where it becomes personal and that's where it becomes real. If there's something we can do today to shorten that line for tomorrow, I suppose that's the conversation we should be having. And the very interesting, you know, sort of conundrum that got thrown up, I'm going to switch this mic here, okay, that got thrown up was, of course, Dr. Chopra talking about how you believe that effectively trade of organs has to be legalized because it's happening anyway. Dr. Mehra was instrumental in designing the laws in our country as far as organ donation is concerned. So I do understand here we have someone who disagrees with the system. I'm going to ask you to respond, Dr. Mehra, because she made a very interesting argument. What's your response to that?
Yes, that was the issue that we were talking when we were trying to frame this law in 1994. Of course, the law came up in 1994. I must say that we started way back in 1989, and we took up the law that was actually available in UK over there, and we sort of worked on that. So there was a group of people on that side and this side over there, and that side would say, even when you exchange kidneys between brothers and sisters, there's some kind of exchange. Nobody gives a donor, nobody is a voluntary donor over there. But I can say that in my own career of 45 years, I've seen one guy. One guy was very rich, super rich, a sugar magnate actually. He, in 1989, wanted, and that was the time when the Organ Transplantation Act was not there. He was very keen to donate his kidney to somebody who was in Ghaziabad. And the Ghaziabad family, you know, the two boys used to come to me, and their sister required a transplant, and the kind of dedication I saw in those two boys. And they said, this is the gentleman who wants to donate kidney to me, to our sister. And I said, how much is he asking for? He said, asking for? He says that I will even take care of the whole expenditure of the transplant. Finally, the transplant was done. This guy turned out to be known to me. He was the chairman of a very big sort of business house. Yeah. He has donated the kidney in 1989, is still living very well. He used to play, squash,
even after the transplant and doing very well. So, you know, the selling of organs, like the kind of things that you were saying, Dr. Chopra, it will not work in a country like India. There used to be a time in Mumbai when all these sheikhs will come over here and they go to these jugiwalas and all that, and they will buy the organ. The guy gets only 10,000, whereas the dalals and all that will get something like 4 or 5 lakhs and all that. This kind of a system will not work
okay.
in India.
So I just in response to that, your point is that.
That is exactly my point. As long as you tag it as illegal, you have these middlemen, you have these unethical practices. Why do you need that? I would say you should legalize and regularize this business. As simple as that. You have people who need organs, you have people who are willing to give organs. Let there be a trade-off.
Well, you know, in the organ transplant bill that we made in the first instance, the living donors were defined as the parents, the siblings, the children.
Hmm.
Of course, we have to be very careful when somebody comes, you know, I'm the father and this is my 18 to 19 year old young son, he will give kidney to me. We are very, very careful because we found that that was not his son. I have never seen a parent asking for a kidney from their child. But then the donor pool was expanded. We said, okay, we also have the grandparents and grandchildren. Now there is a talk also the further expanding the donor pool to include the cousins, the first cousins.
I just want to, if I may, get a sense from the rest of the panel as
yeah.
well as to what they feel about this. Is this the solution? Sam, you haven't spoken at all. So the argument here is we should allow for trade legally, Dr. Chopra, and regularize. Or should we encourage more and more people to pledge their organs, which is perhaps a much longer route to get there?
First of all, a very good afternoon to all of you here, and good morning to you there. So, I caught him with a big yawn, but that was so cute, another cute little yawn. But I know this topic might be a little heavy, like Faye already discussed, for a lot of you children here. And like Faye also did say that we are a huge country and we have so many people who are waiting in line. And how much more is that what we can do? I was very happy to hear all the statistics that Dr. Mehra put out, but that was basically focused on China. And I mean, okay, this is a small joke I was thinking when that was going on. I don't know how many of us really want a made in China body part. So, I don't know how long that will last. Okay, that was a joke, hello, just to lighten the situation because there's a bunch of youngsters and kiddos over here. But, you know, the thing is very, very deep, actually, especially in our country, because there's so much of stigma revolved around organ donation. And it is pan cultures. So I have been an ambassador, Jay is here right now, for Mon Foundation for a lot, many years. And that is a thing which we used to talk about in wherever we used to have. In Nanavati Hospital, we had a full, panel exactly like this. And the main topic that hindrance that was there in our country is that a lot of cultures think, oh, the body should not be desecrated after the soul has passed. So whether you're a Muslim or a Sikh or a Christian or Hindu or whatever, we found that problem pan-religions.
Yes.
So that is one thing, A, that we need to get out of our, you know, whole concept of that it is against our religion or it is against our culture. I think that is where this educated youth comes in.
Mm.
You know, where they can carry this message forward. You can talk to people about it. The awareness needs to spread. That this is a necessity today. It is all scientific. There's nothing that the body is going to be desecrated or the soul will not pass onto the seventh heaven or the tenth heaven or wherever it goes after we all gone. But at the moment, that same soul can save so many lives. I mean, what better good deed or what better karma or what better punya than that, that any soul will ever accumulate of all the deeds that they've done in their living life. So that for me is a very, very important aspect that we need to reach out to, not only within our colleges or every, but I think even in our interiors. as far as what the discussion, coming back to what Dr. Mehra and Madhu Aunty here were talking about, is I'm kind of on the fence a little. For example, I work a lot for wildlife as well. As everyone knows that a lot of the rhinos are almost extinct, the white and the black. And why are they extinct? They're extinct for their horns, right? So there was this entire movement and a discussion open in South Africa where they're almost legalizing keratin trade and rhino farming, where the rhinos are going to be bred and humanely they're going to be bred for the keratin so that there is no illegal poaching. You see, that is a thought that went across, because otherwise our animals are going extinct. So to a certain extent, to stop that illegal poaching, they have made a movement which can be used like ostrich farming, or like, for example, so that the breed or the, you know, doesn't go extinct, it lives on. Well, as far as human beings are concerned, the concern over here is that even if we legalize the organ donation, there will still be an amount of illegal trading happening. You will not be able to curb that until and unless there is a collaborated, orchestrated effort internationally and globally and under one umbrella.
Yeah.
Then until and unless that happens, and it's a serious effort, it's not going to get curbed.
Dr. Matthews?
Yeah, I was just thinking, I'm not comfortable with it. I'm very sorry. The thing is, they are doing it out of poverty. And they're giving, is that, I understand that way, yeah? They don't get out of this poverty. We were discussing this. For the time being, they get the money for, you know, that particular organ, but they really don't get out of their problems. So are we really helping them, or are we, and they're also malnourished. They're, you know, they have all other complications.
So after donation, after surgery, care will then become more difficult?
You have to decriminalize it, disincentivize it, and probably give them an incentive. For an example, I give. Suppose it's a legal trade, and you need a organ, and you have the money to buy it, and there's a donor who doesn't have the money. So you take care, ensure that his pre-workup is your responsibility, because you're coming under this umbrella that says it is not illegal trade. Your pre-workup is done, your health is checked, your organ is matched, your post-operative taken care of, and thereafter when you get the money, it's your money. There's no middleman taking it away. You're not paying for anything. You get that money for which you pledge your organ. It is safer. It is quicker. It is easier. Yes, for lack of education, lack of information, lack of values, they might blow up that money, like Slumdog Millionaire children. They blow up their money. People can blow up their money. That's their call. It's another matter. But what they have done is a courageous deed. We should take care of them.
We'll let you cook that ethically. Yeah. Yes, Ms. Jaira.
With all due respects, I also disagree, because there has been, so when there was a study that was conducted in Tamil Nadu on a group of such living donors who donated one of their kidneys for money, and thereafter when a follow-up was done, it was found that many of them ended up with kidney failure themselves. So A, we do not have concrete outcome studies of what happens to these living donors. Do they go for a regular checkup? Many of them didn't even get paid. Yeah, so this is because of the middlemen. They didn't get paid what they had been promised. They never got out of their poverty situation. So this entire thing, so they were asked, what is your advice? And they said, we would not really advise anyone else to do what we did. It didn't really help us. And in fact, it has landed them up in more trouble. Similarly, in Iran also, they have a system where it's like paid donation. Blood money is paid and it's legal and it's controlled. And yet, a similar study that was conducted in Iran showed that most of them ended up with kidney failure themselves. So,
yes,
I wanted to just say that, you know, money for blood, blood for money, or organ for money, I don't think it's going to really go too far. The problem that we have to address, and I showed you that we are only doing about 7,000 to 10,000 transplants in this country as a whole, whereas the need is about more than 2 lakhs. What we need to do is to also grow our, you know, expand our donor pool from the legal point of view. But what we have lacked behind is the diseased organ transplantation in this country. We are doing barely very few, and thanks to Mohan Foundation over there and their group, that they have encouraged. So South India has done a few more than North India. The North India, this situation of organ transplantation using cadaver donors is really dismal. This is something that we have to improve. You see that in Europe and North America, 90% of the organ transplants are being done through the diseased organ transplant group.
But they're waiting.
And they have a chain. And they have a chain. You know, they sort of match them. You know, for example, I worked in Eurotransplant in Holland, and that was way back in 1976, and Europe was like one family there. We had a guy who had a road traffic accident in Munich, actually, and his best HLA matched kidney was there in Paris, somewhere over there.
So
this was being done way back in 1976 over there.
Okay,
this is something that we have to improve in.
I want to open this up to questions, and I know you guys have questions. Yes, we are
not. After friends again.
Would you stand up, please?
I have this question. If you're talking about legalizing it as a trade in the nation, say it will eradicate poverty or at least give a relief to them, but in the end, it will be a poor person selling his organs out of poverty and a rich person buying it. What about the middle class people? How do they get access to this? Because as far as I know, the operations that are carried out for transplanting this and the post-op procedure as well, it's not really cheap. And if you're doing it, you're just entertaining a certain high class of the society. The people at the bottom, in the middle, they don't come into question at all.
Okay.
But what if someone who is really poor and needs maybe a kidney transplant or a liver transplant and does not have money to even cover the cost of the operation itself? Why do we not think about them?
So basically the argument is, will we be then perpetuating the poor is always giving, the rich always receiving? Dr. Chopra? Because then effectively what happens to a transplant
This is
patient?
Where people like Dr. Mehra come,
yes,
who enact laws, who help the decision makers to provide better health care, better facilities, medical insurances, whatever they can do. We have government hospitals where it doesn't cost much, but you should encourage those hospitals to set up quality centers, good centers, at par with private, and you should discourage middle people. I am completely for it, middle persons for hospital admissions, middle persons for any donation, middle person for anything have to be removed from equations. If you're talking about the people who can't afford it, I gave you an example from my family. She was just a junior professor in JNU, wasn't making enough. But they went to a sleazy hospital. They could have gone to a government hospital where this facility could have been provided. Why wasn't it done? This is what we need to work on. Not just a poor man giving his kidney for money. That is not where it stops. It is a combined effort of everybody, the lawmakers, the decision makers, the ethics department, the social service providers, everybody.
So I just have a question on this. So if the argument here is that you are legalizing the organ trade, right? Do you think that has potential of increasing the amount that is provided? For example, as we all know that the demand is much more and the supply is much less. That has been growing over the years statistically, right? So by legalizing, my one question is that you think this will meet the demands, or do I feel, for example, like I said, when I started with, I said I'm a little over the on the fence here, is because I do feel that the only way to increase the supply of people who are really in dire need is by spreading awareness, by by reaching out to people, by making people come forward and pledge their organs, that okay, under whatever circumstances, once I'm dead, this is my card, and here is where I want to give my organs. Does that, do you think that will speed up the process?
We should not see organ trafficking or organ donation unidimensionally. It has many dimensions. You have allogeneic donations, where also they can have renal failure after I've donated to my husband, maybe I would fall sick. So these are the after effects of donations which we have to be aware of, and it cannot be a unidimensional business. It has to be a multi-pronged, and every part of the society who are dealing with or who are directly, indirectly related to organ trade have to come forward and make it simpler, make it cheaper, make it accessible, make it available, make it ethical, make it humane, and make it affordable. It's very important to go through all this, and you can't just say ki acha gareeb ne de diya ameer ne le liya. Aisa ho hi nahi sakta. Gareeb to majboori mein aaj de raha hai, par agar humne aisa kanoon banaya ki wo majboori mein nahi de, willingly de. Aap blood mangte ho, when you need, suppose like my husband needed 36 units of blood when he was being operated. Mere paas itna blood nahi tha. I could not have donated that. We've got it from donors who willingly donated. We got it from people who charged me for it. Hota hai. You can't fight this. The demand is there. The supply has to be created, whether by voluntary donations, whether by willingly saying that after my demise, you can take my organs, or buy it for money.
But I think the only question then is that, you know, even if we rationalize or legalize the whole system, at what point will an individual decide to donate an organ, which is very different from donating blood, is in desperation, one would assume, in need of money.
That's exactly what my doubt was, that a person, blood is something, okay, you are regenerating and everything, and if hearing something like this, that the group that donated earlier for money, also, you know, a lot of them had kidney failure, this will discourage anyone who would willingly want to come, because they might not want to take the chance of going through a kidney failure or anything that is hampering their future. So that will be detrimental to the entire cause, right? So according to me, again, my number one vote is honestly
to get people
awareness,
to
awareness
yes.
Countrywide.
Yes.
Do we have questions?
This is another issue I wanted to talk about, the awareness issue. I can tell you one example. I went first time to the UK in Oxford in 1976. This is 1976, three-fourths of the population of Oxford was already HLA typed, and they were carrying their donor card over there. This is something that we need to do. We need to create more awareness camps of the type that we're doing now. I think the television there, Faye has a very important role to play over there. Create awareness on the television. How many times we talk about such kind of thing on the television there?
Yes.
Very few times.
The young lady in the red top, go ahead. Yes.
Hello. First of all, I'm deeply troubled by the constant use of the phrase that organ trade needs to be legalized. In our country, we have organ donation, which is legal. And when this conclave began, the very first thing that happened was we all were informed about what organ donation is, how the entire process is. And it is our choice if we want to donate a certain part of our body. So this is about concern through us. Now, when we are talking about the poor selling their body parts because of money, we are actually defeating the purpose of organ donation in the first place. We are here not, when we are pledging our organs, we are not doing it for money at all. So why should the poor do it for money? It's like just supporting those memes which say that if you want to buy an iPhone, just go and sell your kidney and buy one. So my point is, if we are asking, if we are pursuing people to go for something as noble as organ donation, why should the poor, or why should anybody for that matter, do it for the sake of money? Shouldn't the awareness be spread in such a manner that the poor, they do it if they want to do it? This is not a business that we want to set up. We want to do it as a noble cause. So it's everyone's choice. And we need to spread awareness in that way. So what are your thoughts about that?
Thank you. So I just want to do a show of hands again. Obviously now everyone knows what organ donation is. How many of you are ready to pledge? Okay. They're all ready to pledge. They're all
really good.
Pledge. Yeah.
I think the discussion must shift from sale and trade to education, awareness.
So actually, so if I may, this is perhaps, at least in my career, this is the strongest panel I have come across as far as, organ transplant surgery is concerned. So do you guys have questions for the panel? Yes. So her point is, if the organ trade was legalized, it would just be a short-term solution, but the long-term shortage would still remain. Yes, Dr. Matthews.
I think if we can move towards the thinking of what I showed you in the Dutch registry, if they can have that kind of system where people go and register, everyone has to register and have an option whether to opt in or opt out, that would be a good way.
Yeah.
That would be a start, because that awareness is okay, it's also good, it's important, but those who really want to be in will be in the registry.
One good thing about all this happened is, I thought some people were yawning, but y'all are awake. You have distinguished between organ donation and organ trade. I'm very happy for y'all, proud of you kids. Good.
Sure.
To add to what the lady over there said, yes, we strongly believe that organ donation is what works, especially in a country like India, because we briefly spoke about presumed consent law making it a success in countries like Spain and Croatia. But remember that these are the countries which have the entire healthcare system is run by the government. There is no difference between a private, and there is no privatization of the hospitals. It's just public hospitals over there. Whereas in a country like India, where you have extremely expensive corporate run private hospitals, and you have government hospitals as well, and it's a huge difference, right? And in such a country, it's very difficult to bring in the sale of organ, regularizing it, because the trust in the healthcare system is not there. My father would rather walk into a small clinic doctor rather than going to a large hospital for simple ailments, you know. So he'll say, "Nahi, ye hospital mein jayega, to wo nichod ke nikal dega, wo wapas ghar aadmi ko wapas bhejega nahi." So this is the kind of thought process that we have. So it's very difficult to talk about regularizing organ trade. Yes, organ donation is the future, altruistic organ donation is the future, and to emphasize, deceased organ donation is the future. But till such time as deceased organ donation becomes popular and a big thing, people do not have an option but to go to their living relative, but to go to their near relative. I am a kidney recipient myself. Do you know what I went through when my mother volunteered to donate one of her kidneys to me? It was not an easy process. I had the biggest confusion, dilemma in mind, that what if something happens to my mom? Is it worth living a life like that? I don't want anything like that to happen. You know, so it's not easy when someone decides, yes, I'm taking an organ from my mother or from my father or brother. It's a very, we were literally torn apart, and I kept postponing the decision to the extent that I had to undergo dialysis in the interim period. So it was not an easy decision at all. And therefore, living donation should only be a temporary thing till such time as deceased organ donation becomes popular. But in the meanwhile, people don't have an option. That's why they're going to a living donation.
So I want to talk more about, at this point, pledging, what we can do to get more people to pledge, how we can educate more people. how we can perhaps take out, you know, move away from the idea that the soul will not pass on, or our religion doesn't allow it, or, you know, in the second coming we wouldn't be full human beings if our organs have been taken out. I want to take a few more questions on this side. Yes.
Good.
Oh. You forfeit because you were yawning.
Good morning.
Okay, go on, go on. Go on, go on.
Good afternoon. So, thank you. So my question is that with the opt-out policy, if we do bring it about in the country, like in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha kind of decisions going through, and the bill is passed for opt-out, do you think it will result in a Rajiv Gandhi part 2 kind of situation? Because it's a... Sanjay Gandhi, when he tried to...
The forced sterilization.
The forced sterilization came about. So it's a kind of same problem of entrenching on someone else's body rights. So will that come about and make the discussion push back?
Yeah, I think the fundamental problem with an opt-out policy in India is information. So without information, then consent becomes an issue. Dr. Mahesh?
For any organ, for things like this, you require a consent. And you have to be of sound mind at that time when you, you know, become an organ potential donor. So I don't think it will lead to a Sanjay Gandhi, because that was forced. This is not forced. This is you choose whether, out of your own autonomy, you choose whether you want to be a donor or not. So.
Yeah. I think an interesting aspect would be, although they're nightmarish places for anybody to go, but the RTOs, where we go to get our licenses, because we have a large number of accidents and a large number of potential donors come out of road accidents, to have someone seated at the RTO to ask somebody, listen, here is the information. I can answer your questions if you want to. Would you like to be a donor? Chipka out to your driver's license. That's in your pocket at all points. Yes.
So just to add to you what you said, Faye, last year the central government, Mr. Nitin Gadkari, did pass a bill whereby driving license has been, you know, in India, all the driving licenses now will have the organ donation wish. Unfortunately, it's not yet implemented in the RTOs. It's not yet trickled in. But we are doing something about that. We are taking it up.
It will eventually come. Now, again, the thing is battling, again, the stigma of superstition and everything. When I was speaking to a few of the RTO officers or my friend, traffic cops, and they said mostly what happens is when something like this is to be implemented, when a person is sitting right there, when a youngster is getting a license, they say, "Arey, shubh shubh bolo." You know, ye kya de rahe ho aap saath mein? Arey, shubh shubh bolo. You know, that kind of a thing which needs to be battled. So, they say license de rahe ho aur aap accident ki baat kar rahe ho. You know, so a lot of this superstitious nature of people needs to be targeted, where it has to be done actually in a very delicate manner.
It might also encourage them to wear helmets more.
Yeah, that is true actually. That you might
like, wear,
you
know, wear your helmet or sign this donor form.
Yeah. Wear a helmet or then become a donor. Either way. So it's like, yeah, sorry, you were saying something.
I wanted Dr. Abraham to talk about a bit about your Harmony Foundation, because when I talked to you, you said about 10 to 15,000 children stolen, and maybe they end up serving as donors. Is that the issue that you were trying to raise?
Yeah, this is what Mr. Kaila Satyarthi told us, that his organization has come out with the fact there are 40,000 kids who are missing in the nation today. They're not found. So that was, and they could have been kidnapped for these.
Yeah, I will actually second this. I thought this topic probably must have been discussed earlier. So most of the children that get trafficked in India, when I've done my work with, I used to work with a lot of these street children. A lot of the runaways who are found on railway platforms and stuff. Now, first of all, there are gangs that operate. So human trafficking is a huge system that is not only India. You'll be surprised to know that's an entire international chain that functions. So if you think that a child is kidnapped in India and mostly probably found in India, you'll be shocked that child probably be found in Istanbul somewhere. Because there is a huge chain of human trafficking, and for various reasons. So all these children are then divided. I mean, it's really dark once you start exploring, working, learning the statistics. Most of these children are then categorized. Some are sold into prostitution, whether they are young boys or young girls. They are smuggled into different countries. Some are probably just sold for their body parts. It's inhumane. It's completely inhuman. And they're actually categorized in these. So it's not that most of this percentage of children actually end up, just for, organ trade. But there are different kind of trades. I don't want to explore or go deep into that right now. But, just depress everyone who's sitting here. But unfortunately, that is exactly what happens. And you'll be surprised, a lot of, I was just reading up actually when you were talking about China. There's an incident that has happened in China where a teenager, okay, now this is for all of y'all, as what she did say, that you want an Apple phone, you go and sell your kidney. And that's happened in reality. In China, just Google that incident, 10 worst incidents on organ trafficking. And that pops up, where a teenager, and there was this entire college where all these young teenagers were doing this, they were contacting these hospitals, going and selling their kidneys, and suddenly that kid had a new laptop and a new phone. And the mom was like, what the hell is happening? How did you get this? Where did you rake up this money for this? And he turned around and said, oh, I just went and sold my kidney. So not realizing how these young minds also can be influenced. So there is a lot more that goes into this.
Is the argument here, Dr. Bataya, for you as well, is the argument here that if we get more and more people to pledge organs, that over a period of time, the market for illegal trafficking will actually come down?
Will diminish.
Yes, definitely. Yes, definitely. And that's the reason we're having this conference, is to encourage the youth to come forward and pledge the organ and make this a movement. Because whatever the youths do, it happens. So that's why I think we asked Faye also coming here, because she's a youth icon, I would say. She's a rock star. So we wanted to start this thing of pledging organs, which, because here we had so many counter views, and that will continue because each person has the opinion. But the best solution is pledging of organs.
Pledging organs,
which can bring this.
Yes,
down.
The young lady, go ahead. Pledging, yeah.
Yeah, so if pledging becomes, if everybody pledges and eventually donations raise, so the illegal trade or the trafficking will reduce. It might reduce, but I don't think it will diminish, like it will go completely off, because there are, like ma'am said, there are kids being sold outside of India. There are kids being, so the organs will still, I think the trade will still go on, and the, the organs still will be going out of India, so I don't think it will completely go. I think there should be some law.
This is not a silver bullet solution, obviously, but yes, go ahead.
So the logic here is, once you start pledging, there's more awareness. So it's all a demand and supply, right? So if you read statistically, the demand is much higher and the supply is very less on legal organ donation. Now, once you start increasing that supply, rather people would go the right way. Unless there's a desperate situation, then you do a crime, right? So that is the basic logic of it all. So as I'm very thankful to Xavier's and to Dr. Bram and everyone here on this panel, that they found the time to come here and actually talk to y'all. I feel a lot more initiatives like this need to be undertaken. I'm telling you, there's very, very, very less awareness. I do support a lot many organizations. But unfortunately, the least that I do appearances for or initiatives that are taken are actually for organ donation, which is very, very surprising. You know, I've actually spoken to so many of these, our countries full of godmen all over, right? And they have these huge satsangs which are like 50,000 lakhs of people and stuff. And I've actually spoken to them to collaborate, to make short films for them, to screen when they have these lakhs of people sitting in their audiences, you know, to reach out, which I think should become a necessity by even the government, or to make a move that whenever there's a large gathering, a small screening like this should happen, you know, whether it's in theatres or it is in, anywhere, which is, and that's all it needs. It needs that correct awareness.
Let me take one last question. Right at the back. Yes, go ahead. No, but one moment. This, yes, I'll come back to you. Go on. Yeah, show your voice.
No, we're sending you the mic.
Speak from the diaphragm.
No, everyone goes pass it on.
Yes.
So are we as a generation normalizing the play, or is it like too prevalent to be
classical? So I think this question has come up, and if I may answer it about this whole kidney bech ke iPhone khareedo, is this insensitive, is it normalizing? But really, I mean, we should stop going after the comedians for everything. The truth is, if this sort of thing is happening in society, you will have satire and jokes and memes and everything come up around it. We should be fighting the trafficking, not the jokes. Right? If you fight the trafficking, then that's the real problem. So I don't really take that much offense to the jokes. Are iPhones expensive? Yes, they are. Are there cheaper options? Yes, there are cheaper options. You don't really need an iPhone. Like, you don't need 350 rupee coffee from Starbucks, but people still go out and buy it. That's the joke. But should that stop us from fighting the problem? No. We should always, and I think this is generally the view. We tend to take offense at the jokes. And just like last night, by the end of the night, the television channels answered the question of whether or not Kunal Kamra was right based on what he was doing. They answered it themselves. We should look at the actual problem. The actual problem here is trafficking of organs. And that, for me, should be our focus for a solution. Yes, go ahead. Yes. Oh. Yes.
I do have a question, plus I have my self-experience. Like, I'm one of the benefited persons from organ donation. So basically, I was suffering from corneal dystrophy, and I underwent a surgery. So basically, I had to wait for more than a year to get a cornea, and the criteria was like, I need someone just around my age, and my doctors wanted to operate me before I turn 18. So due to the list of like many people in the queue for waiting, sadly it didn't happen, but I got a donor who was some 16, 17 years old girl whose cornea was allotted to me. So yeah, as Ravina ma'am said, the superstitions or whatever, the mentality within the Indians which prevents them to pledge to donate organs, or like if I donate his organs, he would he would be reborn as a blind or whatever, without a kidney or whatsoever. Yeah, thank you.
But God bless you, son. We are happy for you. God bless you.
I want to say that the government has done a lot. For example, in AIIMS, we established an organization called ORBO, Organ Retrieval Banking Organization. Yet we only do about 2 or 3 disease donor transplantation annually. Government has now made what is called NOTO, the National Organ Transplantation Organization. NOTO, ROTO, and SOTO. Yet the number of disease donor transplantation that we are doing in India is very, very low. I think we are not doing much towards education. I will put the whole discussion on the door of Faye. She has a very important role to play. We should have many more discussions like this. How many in this hall will end up signing a sort of form for your organs? How many of you? Still very few. Still not all.
Don't seem to have reached the guys
this,
in the back.
This is a question I want to ask. All those who did not raise their hands up, why would you not want to pledge your organs? Why would you not?
Yes. Go ahead.
Thank you. I'm glad you brought it up. You know, in spite of all the discussions that we've had about organ trafficking, I'm very proud to say that there are very robust laws which are in place. It's not... No, let me complete. No. Sorry?
Okay, don't heckle. Let her finish answering your question.
She knows everything. Listen to me, listen to me. No, I think you're under some kind of misunderstanding. We are talking about a legal organ donation. We're not talking about illegal trade. If you go to any quack and say, oh, I'm pledging my organs, take my organs and have fun and make money, that's not going to work. But if you have a proper card and tomorrow you obviously, God forbid, are in a situation where you are, where your organs are being donated, you'll obviously be in a respectful, in a respectful place, which your parents would know what is happening or your family members know. When you carry that card in your wallet, it registers you automatically as a donor,
actually,
right? And there is a legal process.
Can you explain to us the legal process?
Yeah, that does go through.
Let's assume I have a card in my wallet.
Yeah.
And I'm now, for whatever reason, if... Okay, you want to show your card, all right. Tell us, Ms. Jairam, tell us what happens after that.
I'll tell you that. So, yes.
Post accident. Let's assume post traffic accident.
All right. So, every state that has implemented the organ donation program have a proper nodal agency, which is a quasi-government body, but also works independently. It's an NGO and it's a quasi-government body. And all the waiting list, so people who are waiting to receive an organ, they need to register themselves and put themselves on a waiting list. Now, this waiting list is essentially controlled by this quasi-government nodal agency of the state. Now, whenever there is a brain dead donor in the city, immediately an intimation goes from that particular hospital to this particular nodal agency, and the nodal agency does the job of allocating the organs strictly as per the criticality of the patient. The money doesn't count, there is no conditional donation which is accepted or allowed. People cannot say, I will donate provided ek kidney mere relative ko mile. No. Is he or she on the priority? Only then it will be allotted to them. Does it match? And whomsoever is on top of the waiting list and most deserving in terms of criticality or the need of the hour, such people are only allocated organs. Now, about the donor card. Donor card is today not a legal document. Just because you've signed up the donor card, it doesn't mean automatically your organs get retrieved. No. It's a symbolic expression of your wish. We encourage people, each and every one of you all, whomsoever takes the pledge, please go home. It is a conversation initiator with your parents, with your loved ones, so that tomorrow if something were to happen to me, my relatives would know, my loved ones would know, this is what she had wished for.
Exactly. And then there, as far as I know, is there's a number on my card where you do contact. I don't know if
that's
still
a toll-free.
Just tell them about that.
So whenever something were to happen to me, I don't know, 20 years down the line, 40 years down the line, but see, death is something, even though it's a taboo topic, death is something that is bound to happen to each and every person who is sitting out here. That is a one certain thing that is bound to happen. And whenever this should happen, our loved ones must know what our wish was. And on the donor card, there is a toll-free helpline number, which, you know, I spoke to you all about earlier. So this completes the loop, because at that moment, family members need not be running around. So when they call the number, our counselors help them out, guide them about these are the options that the family members have. And it's a pan-India national organ donation helpline.
So
this
also,
is how.
If I may,
one other point I want to raise in view of that. Once you sign a card, you're only expressing your will. After the death, the body belongs to the next of the kin.
Yes.
Nobody can take out organs from the body over there. The transplant coordinator of the hospital will still go and talk to the next of the kin, take their yes, but the point is that the next of the kin would then say, well, if she was so keen in her life
the
that she would like to donate, it becomes easier, But you still have to take the...
If I may just add one thing, I feel very disheartened when such young people have so much pessimism about our country. It's not so bad. It really isn't. And it is your country.
And you have to have
hope.
You have to have faith.
And you have a happy story over there. He was benefited by it.
Exactly.
Remember, I have been benefited by it. Remember, today if I'm sitting here, I have the second chance and I'm working for this cause because I have been benefited somewhere. Okay, so please have faith that our loved ones, whenever they were to go through such a thing, or any, God forbid, but any of y'all were to go through such a thing, you will be benefited, and it will happen through a proper channel.
So I just want to point out something to you. Here, sitting in front of you is Dr. Mehra, who is the dean of the greatest hospital in this country, who was part of the team that wrote the laws about organ donation. He's sitting in front of you in person. We have doctors, we have Dr. Chopra, we have someone who's benefited, we have someone who's benefited. This is a fantastic group of people to be having this conversation with. So I'm glad you asked the question, because the only way to actually remove the pessimism is information and research. But I just want to tell you, like person to person, it's not that bad. We've come a long, long way in the last 73 years. I'm not saying the country is perfect. There's a lot for you to fix, but it's not that bad. Don't lose hope. Should we take one more question? Oh, you have the mic, yes, okay.
Sorry. I think nationally as well, we need to compile a mandatory database list, like how Dr. Matthew had stated. A lot of European countries, even France, is making a mandate towards making a nationwide registry compulsory, where at least they have people with answers whether they want to pledge or not. And that's under a national database. So should anything happen tomorrow, they have the people immediately ready in front of them who are willing to pledge and who are not willing to pledge.
I think that's beautiful. I think one of the most important things we can do is try and ask as many people as possible. A lot of times the answer is no for want of asking, because nobody has asked them. So the other thing that...
I wanted to know how many of you who did not raise your hands would like to raise it now?
From the back, actually, the back half of the room.
How many of
Should
you
we do another
who did not
hands?
Raise your hand that you want to pledge?
They don't know for what. So what he's asking, let this be a guidebook for, let's leave the last one. Now I am going to ask you again, that here we are all talking about awareness, spreading the good work, doing some good work, and we're talking about donating our organs. How many of you understood that? Right. That is a good thing. Now, how many of y'all would want to pledge? Again, see all those hands who understood there, some of them, now don't want to pledge. The reason, that is what we're asking. Why are you not, even after understanding what this is all about, still hesitant? So what are the fears? We are all here, though Faye omitted me out of the good group of people here. So it's just the doctors and the dean. So since I'm a little invisible here. Okay, I like Kunal Kamra. Does that help? That doesn't help. No, actually, personally, I don't like him because he makes very personal and, personal and bad jokes. But the ban on him was not justified. That I will stand for. Nonetheless, everyone has two sides of a coin. When she came, so you want to say that Rose?
Ravina came. She gave rose to all of these on my right. She left me out. She left me out.
See, this is karma. I left you out, she left me out. So now let's get back to the thing. How many of you still have a doubt in the mind or have this hesitation? Besides you, how many of y'all would go ahead and influence more people to do this?
Yeah, that is more important.
How many of you will take this word ahead? How many of y'all will talk to your families, talk to people, make them aware, become ambassadors for this cause?
There's more.
That's all. Let me count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, a zillion hands. The rest of y'all are hungry. Lunchtime, okay.
Yeah, 1 second. I just want to intervene. That young student who stood up and had a lot of concern of what the government would do. Assuming, I'll tell Dr. Mehra here, this is a 1.3 billion country. Our government is not up to the mark. We all understand. But assuming, taking your point of view, how would you lose, assuming that the government is not doing it? Assuming the government is not, you say that you doubt whether. How does it matter to you?
Really, so these things should come out. See, I do understand if it's a donor is living and wants to give these questions, but this is pledging once you're dead. Once you're dead, how does it matter? Your organs will be either burned somewhere, thrown somewhere in the rivers, or it'll be buried. You understand what I'm trying to say? So unless we get this thing off our mind and actually really pledge and also pledge that you'll go and tell somebody about it, this country will continue to have this kind of trafficking.
Yes. So I'm going to leave it here. I will be at the desk outside pledging my organs.
Yeah, please.
Okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. Yeah, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Fawari Clement Olajide, and I'm a student of Civics and Politics. I just completed my MA, and I'm waiting for PET to start my PhD. And regarding this topic going on now, I think it's a very good topic. But my answer to the question which has been thrown to the audience, that why people do not want to volunteer to donate their organs, it may be two things. Like, for me, two things: individual choice and the belief choice, parent choice, society choice. But the most important is individual, the donor. When the donor accept to donate his or her organs, but sometimes the society may involve, the parent may involve. And we all know, as youth, we are not so much independent. We are still under our parents, and we need to follow what they told us. But now, if we disobey them, if we do it at the end, when bad things happen, they will tell you, we told you, but you don't want to listen. So you have to face the cross. So belief is there, society is there, all these things have to be included. So this is my own addition to what is being discussed here this evening. Thank you.
That is the thing. Even though you are under your parents for now, but you are the next generation. You are the one who are going to take this country forward, your country forward. So that time when your decision making comes, you need to take this message forward. Children actually can be the biggest teachers for their parents. Do you know that? Because they are the ones who are going to form decisions much later. So once you evolve, you need to make your parents understand as to how important this is and bring them also onto this. We face this with a lot of environment issues also.
Yes.
Because they say, oh, our parents don't listen to us. The water tap is leaking. It's leaking. When we tell them, shut it, they say, oh, so what? It is just one glass of water. What's the big deal? So that's the thing about the children. You've got to tell your parents, if you love me, do what I tell you to.
All right, we've run out of time, but we'll be hanging out to answer questions. Thank you. To the doctors on the panel, Ms. Jairam, thank you so much for giving us your time and for having these conversations. I think with every conversation, if we change a few minds, we would have saved lives. That's actually a literal translation to where we are. Dr. Mathai?
Yeah, thank you very much, each one of you that have come, all the panelists here, to come and share your time. Thank you, all of you. All of you have spent time here. But let me tell you one thing. One thing that they said, what is certain in the person's life is death. But only thing, it is uncertain when it
and
comes.
And taxes.
And,
death
and the
taxes.
Uncertainty when it comes, let your organs be used to give somebody else's life. To give somebody else a life.
And Dr. Mathai, just to add, remember, if you can receive, you can also give.
Thank you so much for attending today. Just a small thing, Hami Foundation does a lot of events along these lines. Our main work is more about awareness, about telling people about the real issues around the world. And as such, it would be great to see more of you involved in such social issues. If anyone wishes to intern, please do send us an email at connect@theharmonyfoundation.org. Guys, I'm here. Thank you.
वहाँ पे बैग में रखना क्या पड़ेगा
you quite enjoyed it, the discussion, you know, which happened.
I enjoy being with students because they are such impressionable young minds, and this is such a great opportunity to take the right message across to them about organ donation. They are going to be the gen next, and I think they are the ones who will help their parents and their elders to shake off superstitions and beliefs that have been coming down centuries, and to take this good cause forward. It's the right group of people to connect to.
You work with a lot of NGOs who have worked for women welfare and empowerment. About organ donation, where do you think India is currently? Is there a scope of...
It's not a great statistic, to be very honest. We have a huge scope. I mean, we are a huge nation with a huge population. And unfortunately, like we saw statistically, the demand is much more, the supply is less. And I think the only way to reach out to people is to spread awareness. Unfortunately, pan-religions and pan-cultures, there's a certain superstition that, you're desecrating the body and don't touch the body after the person, as the soul has passed on, or the soul will be, not received well if they're desecrated, or will be born blind in the next birth. There's so many of these, superstitions that people like us have to fight through to educate them, to say that nothing like that happens. In fact, you are earning good karma. You're doing a good deed. By probably with one person, if five organs are donated, you're changing their life or giving life to five more people who are in desperate need. So, I mean, what better good deed or good karma than that?
Right. Lavina, we see a lot, there are not many film stars who are involved in such causes the way you are, the way you spoke, you have knowledge, you have done the work. Do you think film stars should be more involved at the ground level for these causes?
I have a few causes that I very strongly believe in. One definitely being the girl child, then our environment and the wildlife, and our forests, because ultimately that is our future. What kind of a planet are we giving to our children ahead? If there is no oxygen to breathe, there are no trees and there are no forests, the sustenance of civilization, it looks very bleak to me, at least in the future. So that is another cause. And then there is, of course, organ donation again, which I believe gives life. So I do believe strongly in a couple of these causes, which I've been an ambassador for Mohan Foundation for, I think, the past 5 years,
at least 5 years,
and I have done a lot of work with them, and they continue to do great work. So we need more people, and we need to reach out to more people. I thank the organizers of Xavier's who gave us this opportunity to talk to these young students today.
You know, there were lots of topics which have been raised by the students, how many students do you think have agreed to
this
pay
is the last
their
question.
I think maximum, a lot of them did. Unfortunately, yes, there are a lot, extra woke children also who are very pessimistic about the future, but these kind of children, I do tell them that have faith, have hope, because you need to become the change. If you give up and you say, okay, no, nothing's going to happen, then actually nothing's going to happen. But if you do believe that you can do it and you can be part of the change and you will become the change, then you can definitely do it. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Firstly, Madhuji, काफी अच्छा insightful discussion था panel पे. क्या कहना चाहेंगे about the students, जिनका आज उन्होंने voice raise किया, questions पूछे. What do you think about the whole discussion that happened?
I'm actually quite impressed कि they were awake and they could actually distinguish between two points of views, and they had their own point of view and very legitimate point of views, and they were were not afraid to ask questions, get the answers from a panel that could give them correct information, which is what we were looking for, to create awareness, create disseminate information, and hope to get more pledged organs.
You know, besides all this conversation, there were few students who, you know, did not raise their hand when they were asked about pledging for the organ donation. What do you think might be the reason behind this?
I think there has to be some prejudice, some fear, but then they are work in progress. That's our effort should be to get them to understand that you can overcome all these prejudices. I mean, you are today's children. We are antique. We carried a baggage of, you know, myths. You don't need to. Y'all are modern day people who are so close to science, so close to reality, so close to clinical facts. You don't have to believe in myths.
There were some kind of memes also which has been raised, you know. Do you think students these days are more into the kind of social media world than rather being in a reality?
Yes, but like Faye said, you should take a joke as a joke and go into the bottom of the real stuff. Because educated children especially, I mean, one doesn't expect from students from St. Xavier's who have actually clawed their way here to be so dumb, I would say.
Right.
Meme is to be enjoyed.
Organ donation ko leke, what do you think, where do you think India is currently, you know, when it comes to trafficking, human trafficking? Like, is there a scope of growth or is there a scope of a good...
I hope not. Trafficking mein growth nahi honi chahiye. India is on top after China. India is on top for trafficking because of abject poverty. That's it. But if we have more organized donations, voluntary donations, maybe we can bridge the gap in India. But what about the rest of the world? It's too large a problem. And like this girl there said, how do I know my organ will not go abroad somewhere to someone else? Illegal trafficking. Very difficult. It's human beings who we are expecting them to be ethical. The people who after my death decide who takes the organ, who is the recipient of my organ, have to be ethical. Where do you draw a line? Very big problem.
And since we are talking about social media, you know, trolling is something which is very normal. And recently, you know, Priyanka has been trolled for her Grammy dress.
Yeah.
What's your take on this?
And I'm glad it happened because I feel it made her stronger, that she lives life on her own terms. As long as she's not harming or hurting anybody, it's her body, she can do what she wants, and she's a beautiful one too. And I sent her a saying that says, it's my life. Whose life am I living? Yours or mine? I can do what I want with my life. So I think that's the philosophy that everybody... Trollers are anonymous people hiding behind their computers who don't have they don't have joy in their lives. That's how I feel. They think they get attention because of saying bad things. They don't mean to say bad things, but they get attention. I don't give much weight to the trollers. It's okay.
Do you like
it? I loved her dress, yeah. She showed me the sample before she wore it. I thought it was a little risk, but she carried it well and she was one of the best dressed. I'm happy about that.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.